It's Monday the 18th of February in 2013 and I'm on my way from Sydney out west and currently travelling over the Blue Mountains on my way to Bathurst, where I hope to meet up with a couple of people today. And at 1:30 we'd plan to meet up with an architect.
Hello, I'm Henry Bialowas. I'm an architect here in Bathurst, among other things. So I'm delighted to be able to talk to you both about the background to the bell tower and how I came to be interested in these various things.
Wonderful.
Now, in my own background, as a student, I did a thesis on sacred geometry, uh-huh. among other things.
Among other uh-huh.
Yeah, it was actually called Architecture of the Dark Side. And what I meant by that was the...
Sorry, what university did you attend?
So, this was at RMIT in Melbourne.
Right, yes, Melbourne.
And this wasn't so much the dark in the sense of the occult, but simply the part of architecture that had been somehow occluded. In other words, we don't deal with sacred geometry in the modern sort of age. Mm. But it's occurred to me that there are many people throughout history that have used sacred geometry and sacred places and sacred sites evolved, but we don't have them in Western culture as such. Mm-hmm. So I was intrigued by these things, but this was like 30 or more years ago, and mm-hmm. of course the thesis proved rather disastrous academically. It just wasn't well received because right. it polarized people, and you know, people in those days really weren't interested in, you know, the subtle underpinnings of you know, ancient architecture and all that kind of thing. There's a different movement about now. I think more people are much more open to these things.
Professor Proudfoot probably helped a little bit of that.
Maybe I don't. That's not right. a name that rings a bell immediately. But anyway, more
he wrote
recently,
the Secret Plan of Canberra.
Oh, okay. Well, I've heard of that vaguely, but I'm not familiar with the actual text or the work. Hmm. But more recently, just a few years ago, I was asked to do a talk at the Institute of Architects annual conference, the country division up in Coffs Harbour.
Wow.
And it was on sacred geometry, so you know, it took quite a while for the idea of sacred geometry as being worth talking about, you know, 30 plus years to kind of come around.
Wow.
So to begin with, I was already steeped in symbolism and geometry as part of my background. Mm-hmm. So when I started, I came across this idea of a town square.
Do you mind me asking?
Sure.
How were you steeped in the symbology?
Well, only in the fact that having written the thesis, I did a lot of reading and thinking about these sort of things and pondering, sure. and then eventually realised that it was a dead end academically. So I kind of, I still introduced these ideas into my architecture, into my work, mm-hmm. but I didn't really talk about it. Mm-hmm. I just thought it would embarrass people if I told them that I'm using, you know, the golden ratio and all those sorts of things. Mm-hmm. But now, you know, it's fairly, I mean, there are television programs on pi and the golden mean and all those sort of things. So it's no big deal or no big secret these days. Mm. But in that sense, I had been programmed myself to be aware of these things when I spot them.
Mm-hmm.
And what occurs to me, some years ago I was asked to do conservation and management studies on the old TAFE College buildings and the Carillion, which you would have noticed in the town square.
Mm-hmm.
And part of that made me realise that Bathurst had a town square in 1833, then subsequently somehow lost it. And that to me was peculiar in itself. And I thought, well, how does a town actually lose a town square? And what does the town square mean, and what, where actually is it? So I came across this map, which is Mitchell's signed map of 1833. And there are some things here that I'd like to point out. He writes the word square here, and then he numbers the squares around it, and if you continue that numbering, 9, 10, 11, 12. So what we're doing, what we're dealing with here is a kind of an enigma in a way, because I suddenly thought, well, what is he telling us here?
He's,
I
mean, telling us something. The obvious thing would be going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Exactly right. So surveyors, you know, by definition, are about giving information to people. And yet this guy was doing that, but in a kind of mysterious, enigmatic way.
Mm.
And I thought, well, what is the meaning of these numbers that seem to spiral out from this point? And then when I looked at the square, I suddenly realised this square doesn't have a boundary. All the other squares do.
Mm-hmm.
This square does not have a number. All the others do. This square does not have a name. And in the middle of it, he puts the word church. So the question that I think Mitchell was asking is, what is it that can't be bound, can't be named, can't be numbered, and begins in a geometric spiral?
Begins and ends.
Exactly right. So that's the Omega point. So what he's talking about here is, what he's created here is not just a blueprint for a town, but a blueprint for a way of life. Because what he's done is put the church in the exact Omega point.
In zero.
And so that's the meaning of that spiral, and that to me is the answer to the riddle. What is it that can't be named, bounded, numbered, and begins and ends in infinity? So that to me, I thought, well, what's, you know, who is this guy Mitchell? And then I came across references to him being a Mason, although I've not been able to confirm that in writing.
Right.
Because
he would have been initiated in an English lodge.
Correct. But not only that, he was part of the 59th Regiment.
Ah, which had its own lodge.
Which had a military lodge.
They did sea initiation.
Not only that, but his patron in Australia was George Murray, who was at that time the Grand Master of the London Lodge.
Mm, mm, mm.
Now, it happens that Mitchell was instructed by Governor Darling to create this town plan, but in his instructions he explicitly excluded town squares for the simple reason that Macquarie was very much into town squares because he was a Mason. Mm. But Macquarie was called back to England and faced a tribunal about his profligate spending on things like town planning and all the rest of it. So there was no way that Darling, who was really a military man purely, was going to come out here and then do much the same and follow in the footsteps of Macquarie. So he said to Mitchell, no town plans, no town squares in the town plan. Now, Darling was recalled to England in 1831. This map came out in 1833, just 2 years later.
Oh, very interesting.
So it's very interesting that suddenly we have a plan for Bathurst, instructed by Darling, but then Mitchell seems to be snubbing his nose at Darling by saying, well, hang on, I'm going to put a square in. This is contrary to his instructions. It's also very well known that Mitchell and Darling were like cats and dogs.
Right.
They really did not agree on anything. They were constantly at loggerheads. Mm. They fought about all sorts of things. And Darling, had he been able, would have had Mitchell dismissed and would have been replaced by one of his sons-in-law, William Dumerick.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't happen for the simple reason because Mitchell's patron was George Murray, who was the minister for the colony and a Grand Master of the London Lodge. So if you look at the symbol of the 59th Regiment, it is this with a bugle, which is the which is a bit of a giveaway in terms of, you know, what that regiment was about. Now, it's probably worth someone finding out the history of the 59th Regiment in England and saying, look, let's pin this down. That'd be great. I haven't been able to myself. I just haven't had the time. But all of those links, I think, are fairly unmistakable. And what's also interesting is that Mitchell didn't start from a zero point. He actually used Macquarie's flagstaff.
Really?
And that flagstaff runs dead through that square. It's exactly 30 chains from that point to the midpoint of the road here. So all of these things, you know, suddenly fall into place. You suddenly realise that this is not an ordinary map of a town square.
This is a kind of a
Masonic, has a Masonic background or predisposition, and he's telling us things. But, you know, no one's really spoken about it in my lifetime, at least, or to my knowledge.
Look, if it was in America, it would be spoken about.
It probably would be on the lines of, you know, Washington, D.C., which is very much Paris, and quite a number of cities around the world. And here we are out on the Bathurst Plains, you know. We've not only transported this sort of ideology or mythology or symbolism, but a Roman town. Because here we have... he originally had the jail here. The jail did end up being on that side. But what transpired subsequently was that we ended up with the this being a marketplace, a spiritual place, and surrounded by government. So all the elements of society are represented. The spiritual, the mundane, as it were, and the authoritarian, civic realm. So it's really a Roman town. Here we are, you know, 2,000 plus years later, transporting a Roman idea with Masonic overlays into a place like Bathurst. So I was intrigued by these sort of things. And subsequently, what's happened is that other people have also picked up this alignment, because when they rebuilt the cathedral, it still remains that the spire of the cathedral is exactly in the centre of the town square. And it lines up with this flagstaff, or what was the flagstaff at that point. Then we have the courthouse, and then we built the carillon right in that spot here. And all three, the spire of the church, the carillon and the courthouse spire, all line up on that axis back to the flagstaff. What's more interesting is that the top of the spire, the top of the carillon and the top of the courthouse dome are all 100 feet above the ground.
That is
signature. I don't think these are accidents. I don't think this is happenstance. I think that they've been, for example, then we look at a cross section through what is King's Parade here, and you would have seen that. There are statues and what have you placed there, and again they cross
War
that
and the Evans
yeah
Memorial.
So they cross the axis in a different direction, but the people who did those were also Masons. Now I'm not a Mason, but when I was asked to look at the competition entry for the bell tower, I knew about these alignments and I felt compelled to follow them, because it made perfect sense in the overall context.
Artistically
it just
made sense.
And at the same time I thought, well, I didn't want to compete with the three major edifices that are already there. They needed, this new building had to be, I felt, subordinate to the predecessors, but it still respected the alignment all the way through and still had its own character, which was unique to the site, but was sympathetic to both the courthouse, the carillon, and the existing churches.
Well, I think you succeeded with that. It is
so all of those things needed to resolve, and that's where architects with some sort of background in these sort of things could be useful. So that's pretty much what's transpired.
That is just amazing.
Yeah, so even with the design of the bell tower, you'll see that that's a Celtic cross, and all those other symbols are there, the use of water.
The four orbs.
Yeah, all of those sort of things, again, are part of that symbolism, and which I think is what helps create civic places, mm-hmm. gives them meaning. And if we are to have sacred ground in Western civilization, these are the sort of elements that they invariably contain.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I'm interested in the actual building now.
Right.
It's got the four vaults.
Yeah.
Is there any particular reason you chose the vaults? To me, quite heavily studied as a non-Mason, right. Very similar to you, I think, and okay. a fascination.
Yeah, yeah.
I walk into there, it's an 18th degree room.
Right.
Like the four vaults talk about, you know.
I don't know much about that side of it. Mm. To me, there were other constraints about the bell tower that I had to meet.
One structure we've been studying is a symbol that is everywhere, which is four discs around a central disc. Now, is there any reason you chose that structure particularly?
Well, again, it had to do with trying to stabilise the building in clay soils. But I also like the symbolism that this was originally going to be, these were fountains originally. They've since been filled in with garden beds. Someone didn't like the maintenance on the fountains, which is a bit sad because I felt that the flow of water was part of that symbolism. But it also was a way of reflecting the sound of the bells back out.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a very subtle inclusion. But it's also a place where people could sit and all the rest of it. So,
and the eternal flame, the water.
Well, all of those. Well, you know, all of those things came together. You know, the fire, the earth, the water, and sound. All those things were part of the elements, in a sense. And to me, it was an important part of the design. But sadly, it's now been converted into a weedy garden bed. So that's life, you know.
We've been deeply studying some of the rituals involved in masonry.
Right, okay.
And how that each one of those orbs represents one of the elements.
Okay.
And that the magician or magus or
stays
in that central position.
Right,
sort of invokes the elements, a common theme that we've...
That's more by accident here than intent. Although I do feel strongly about the use of water around or near buildings. I think water is kind of one of those life principles, you know, and attracts bird life and all sorts of other things. And it was just a lovely quality to the building. But, you know, I recognise also that the church have limits on their funds and maintenance is an issue, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, that's how it all panned out. But I'm not... I don't know a lot about the Masons. I mean, I know that... I think Kathleen's out there, I have read one or two books about Masons and things, but I haven't sort of studied them as a thing in itself. You know, it's been peripheral to, but I noticed that, you know, when you go through history and you look at various things and you think, oh, this is an interesting person, then lo and behold, you discover that he or she is a Mason, mostly he. Well, exclusively he, I think. I don't think they have women in
Masonry. Yes, co-masonry and the Order of the Eastern Star, which I believe is a church, temple in Bathurst, isn't
well,
it?
Well, I think there may well be. I know that Masons have been here a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But I hadn't really studied Masons or Freemasons as such. But
it's
I was
sacred geometry. It's led you into it.
Well, yeah, I came from it from a different direction altogether. It was just by, you know, being puzzled about the configuration of buildings and why they had these strange properties or strange alignments and what have you. And then I started reading and became more and more intrigued with ley lines, which you brought up earlier. And the fact that a lot of, for instance, the Gothic cathedrals are all over springs and wells and streams, as is this one.
Mm-hmm.
Known or unknown.
Known or unknown.
Yeah.
This is sort of part of my thesis that, look, it's impossible for everyone. There's something working through all of us.
Well, one of the things that I remember coming across was that if you look at the conflict between, say, Indigenous peoples and the mining people, whether it's uranium or coal or iron ore or gold or whatever it may be, quite often you'll notice that they occur on what the Indigenous people call sacred ground.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it raised the question in my mind, what's the correlation between a concentration of a particular ore, whether it's uranium or gold or water or whatever, And people's response, like water diviners, have a response to locations of water.
And there's a whole movement of divining for divining minerals as well.
Yeah. So it occurs to me that these people that regard sacred sites as sacred are responding to the natural elements that are concentrated there. Again, whether it's oil or some other deposit, but the fact that it's in concentration is telling them physically something is special about this place, so they regard it as sacred. But it happens to be the location of an iron ore deposit or something else. I don't think that's an accident, because it happens too often. So again, I think that ancient civilizations saw these in sacred terms, whereas we see them in different terms, The two just happen to overlap, but with, strange results. But I don't want to disillusion Indigenous people and their, because these things are sacred, and they may be sacred for all hosts of reasons. But one of them, I think, is underpinned by the fact that there are certain deposits
there.
There's an earth energy. By the fact that one particular element is concentrated there.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, so I made that observation many years ago, and I thought, oh, yeah.
But again, I haven't made that observation. I'm very interested in observation.
Well, it's something that, again, someone with time on their hands could study and say, look, let's systematically look at sacred sites and the conflict that they've had with mining leases or other things, and see whether there is in fact a true correlation,
or
whether
it's a worldwide thing.
Well, that's what occurred to me, was that throughout Canada, for example, and Alaska, there where there are all sorts of mineral wealth and a lot of native populations, that there was always this conflict of sacred ground and sacred sites and all the rest of it with the more mundane interests of modern man. But again, I don't think it's an accident. I think that there are relationships there that are just simply perceived in different ways. Mm-hmm. That's not to say that other things may not be there as well.
Many factors, like you say.
I think so. So, these sites may be sacred for reasons other than the mineral deposit, in other words. So, again, I don't know and can't really comment on that. But, yeah. But that, in a nutshell, I hope that answers some of your questions. The interesting thing about the flagstaff that was placed there by Macquarie, it became the set-out point not just for the whole of Bathurst, because Mitchell used that as his set-out point for the whole town and created an axial plan, but also it became the set-out point for all the surveyors and explorers that subsequently came through Bathurst to map and discover the inland Australia. So it's really the set-out point for the rest of Australia, this very flagstaff. Now, it's most unfortunate that the flagstaff, after probably 60 years being there, withered away or whatever and fell over, and was never quite replaced or noted as its location, and eventually became quite lost. In more recent times, the council found that as an ideal spot to put a toilet block and a sewer vent pipe, which marks more or less where that flagstaff once was. There are now moves afoot by the council, I understand, to rethink this area, because Bathurst is coming up to its 200th birthday, the bicentennial, in 2015, and on the 7th of May, which will be Proclamation Day, when Macquarie placed the flagstaff there in 1815, something hopefully better than a toilet block and a sewer vent pipe might
really
be
there.
It's
the first proper structure.
It's the first construction or piece of structure outside of Sydney, the first inland piece of construction, European construction that is, outside Sydney, really. So in 1815, it's the first thing they erected. That possibly the first thing might have been Macquarie's Bengal tent, but I mean, I'm talking about a permanent structure. This would have been the first permanent structure. The first thing they would have done is put up a flagpole, which would have been a ship's mast. I don't know what size it may have been, 10 metres tall, 30 foot mast, which they would have carried over with drays and what have you, over the mountains, and would have run up the Union Jack. So that would have been the first thing that would have seen in this area as a structure. Flagpole, Union Jack, and invariably the survey marker peg for the rest of Australia. So it has quite a colourful little history in itself.
Really?
But that is where Mitchell, as you can see, notes that quite deliberately.
Very deliberately.
Then we've done a check on this, and it's exactly 30 chains to the center point of that, which, and these were 10-acre blocks. So all of these are in, you know, imperial kind of units of, and fairly even numbers. You know, if you scale that, it's not 33.654 or something, it's exactly 30 chains. And again, these are no accidents, you know, I think that this is quite deliberate. So all of that kind of ties together with how the town grew. And I think it's sad in a way that when we see that this is no longer a flagstaff but a toilet and a sewer vent pipe, shows us that not knowing our history in detail has consequences. You know, the fact that we lost the town square is a consequence of not knowing our history. Losing this is the same consequence. And I think it's sad that we don't, you know, we probably know more about American history and about European history than we do about the subtle underpinnings of our own history.
The subtle underpinnings, that's a very good way of describing it.
So I think these are important elements, you know, and...
And in this, like, we're in the 200th anniversary of the crossing.
Correct,
this year,
yeah, that's
it's
correct.
A pertinent time for it to come out.
So, you know, all of these things have a time and place, I guess, and Canberra is celebrating its 100th this year, 1913. And it was 1813 that they crossed the mountains originally, and within 2 years they'd built a road, quite a magnificent undertaking in itself, you know, 6 months to hack their way through the. Through the mountains and then arrive here. So this is the terminus point for that road, the first road out of Sydney.
Cox's Road.
Cox's Road, that's where it terminates.
It's just amazing.
So there we are.